ولكن لا يعلمون وإذا لقوا الذين آمنوا قالوا آمنا وإذا خلوا إلى شياطينهم قالوا إن معكم إنما نحن مستهزئون الله يستهزئ بهم ويمدهم في طغيانهم يعمهون أولئك الذين اشتروا الضلالة بالهدى فما ربحت تجارتهم وما كانوا مهتدين مثلهم كمثل الذي استوقد نارا فلما أضاءت ما حوله ذهب الله بنورهم وتركهم في ظلمات لا يبصرون صم بكم عمي فهم لا يرجعون أو كصيب من السماء فيه ظلمات ورعد وبرق يجعلون أصابعهم في آذانهم من الصواعق حذر الموت من الصواعق حذر الموت والله محيط بالكافرين يكاد البرق يخطف أبصارهم كلما أضاء لهم مشوا فيه وإذا أظلم عليهم قاموا ولو شاء الله لذهب بسمعهم وأبصارهم إن الله على كل شيء قدير يا أيها الناس اعبدوا ربكم الذي خلقكم والذين من قبلكم لعلكم تتقون الذي جعل لكم الأرض فراشا والسماء بناء وأنزل من السماء ماء فأخرج به من الثمرات رزقا لكم فلا تجعلوا لله أندادا وأنتم تعلمون وإن كنتم في ريب مما نزلنا على عبدنا فأتوا بصورة من مثله وادعوا شهداءكم من دون الله إن كنتم صادقين فإن لم تفعلوا ولن تفعلوا فاتقوا النار التي وقودها الناس والحجارة أعدت للكافرين وبشر الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات أن لهم جنات تجري من تحتها الأنهار كلما رزقوا منها من ثمرة رزقا قالوا هذا الذي رزقنا من قبل وأتوا به متشابها ولهم فيها أزواج مطهرة وهم فيها خالدون إن الله لا يستحيي أن يظلم مثلا ما بعوضة فما فوقها فأما الذين آمنوا فيعلمون أنه الحق من ربهم وأما الذين كفروا فيقولون ماذا أراد الله بهذا مثلا يضل به كثيرا ويهدي به كثيرا وما يضل به إلا الفاسقين الذين ينقضون عهد الله من بعد ميثاقه ويقطعون ما أمر الله به أن يوصل ويفسدون في الأرض أولئك هم الخاسرون كيف تكفرون بالله وكنتم أمواتا فأحياكم ثم يميتكم ثم يحييكم ثم إليه ترجعون هو الذي خلق لكم ما في الأرض جميعا ثم استوى إلى السماء فسواهن سبع سماوات وهو بكل شيء عليم وإذ قال ربك للملائكة إني جاعل في الأرض خليفة قالوا تجعل فيها من يفسد فيها ويسفك الدماء ونحن نسبح بحمدك ونقدس لك قال إني أعلم ما لا تعلمون وعلم آدم الأسماء كلها ثم عرضهم على الملائكة فقال أنبئوني بأسماء فقال أنبئوني بأسماء هؤلاء إن كنتم صادقين قالوا سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم قال يا آدم أنبئهم بأسمائهم فلما أنبأهم بأسمائهم قال ألم أقل لكم إني أعلم غيب السماوات والأرض وأعلم ما تبدون وما كنتم تكتمون وإذ قلنا للملائكة اسجدوا لآدم فسجدوا إلا إبليس أبى واستكبر وكان من الكافرين وقلنا يا آدم اسكن أنت وزوجك الجنة وكلا منها رغدا حيث شئتما ولا تقربا هذه الشجرة فتكونا من الظالمين فأزلهما الشيطان عنها فأخرجهما مما كان فيه وقلنا اهبطوا بعضكم البعض عدو ولكم في الأرض مستقر ومتاع إلى حين فتلقى آدم من ربه كلمات فتاب عليه إنه هو التواب الرحيم قلنا اهبطوا منها جميعا فإما يأتينكم مني هدى فمن تبع هداي فلا خوف عليهم ولا هم يحزنون يحزنون والذين كفروا وكذبوا بآياتنا أولئك أصحاب النار هم فيها خالدون يا بني إسرائيل اذكروا نعمتي التي أنعمت عليكم وأوفوا بعهدي أوف بعهدكم وإياي فارهبون وآمنوا بما أنزلت مصدقا لما معكم ولا تكونوا أول كافر به ولا تشتروا بآياتي ثمنا قليلا وإياي فاتقون صدق الله العظيم.
صدق الله مولانا العظيم. Verily Almighty Allah speaks the truth. Shukran, Jazakallah Khair, and Baita Ramakasi to our very dear brother Abdul Rashid from Malawi, one of our caretakers. MashaAllah, very talented reader. May Almighty Allah accept the glorious Quran reading and may Allah bless us all through the barakah of the glorious Quran. Amin Ya Rabbal Alameen. My dearly beloved Jamaatul Muslimin, I greet you with the universal greetings of love, peace and mercy. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. MashaAllah, alhamdulillah, as I came in and I'm standing here now looking at the shining faces, MashaAllah, the nur of the Hajj is here. Praise be to Allah for bringing back our honorable Hujjaj. May Allah accept the Hajj of all our Hujjaj. And it gives me extra pleasure, honor, to welcome our speaker for today who really needs no introduction whatsoever. The Honorable Ambassador, Brother Al-Hajj Ibrahim Rasool. We have requested him to come and speak to us because there's some very positive changes ahead taking place for our future Hujjaj of 2024, inshallah. First and foremost, to our brother Ibrahim Rasool and his beloved wife, Auntie Rashida, and all the Hujjaj, we say to you, Hajj Maqbool, Hajj Mabroor, may Allah accept the Hajj of all our Hujjaj. Amin. And without further ado, I call upon Brother Ibrahim Rasool to kindly address us. Falyatafaddal Mashkura.
Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen Wassalatu wassalamu ala ashrafil mursaleen Sayyidina wa nabiyina wa maulana Muhammadin sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. My respected brothers and sisters, we give all praise and all thanks to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the cherisher, the nourisher, the sustainer of all the worlds. And we invoke the special blessings of peace and salutation on the most noble of Anbiya, our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for having guided us to yet another occasion of Jumu'ah. Very importantly, the Jumu'ah after the season of Hajj. that our Hujjaj have returned safely, most of them, not all of them. That our Hujjaj have returned healthy, most of them, but not all of them. But certainly, everyone, whether we have returned with illness, whether we have left loved ones behind who perished through the mercy of Allah in the course of fulfilling their Hajj, we know that indeed they have been forgiven, they have been renewed, and they have returned as the ambassadors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bring that spirit of renewal to all our communities, inshaAllah. قال الله تعالى في القرآن الكريم أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وأذن في الناس بالحج. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instructs Nabi Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam to proclaim the Hajj to people, to call people to this Hajj. يَأْتُوكَ رِجَالًا وَعَلَى كُلِّ ضَامِرٍ يَأْتِين. Allah says they will come to you on foot, they will come to you on animals, and they will be lean and emaciated because of this journey. مِنْ كُلِّ فَجٍ عَمِيكٍ. Through deep valleys and distant mountains, they will be tested on their way to this Hajj. Sadaqallahul Azeem. Nabi Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam was skeptical about whether his voice would carry through the four corners of the world in proclaiming this Hajj. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala assured him, said, yours is only the duty to proclaim the Hajj. I will make sure that your voice is amplified to every corner. It is said that the mountains flattened themselves so that there was no impediment to the voice of Nabi Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam across the geographies of the four corners of the world, nor impediments across the ages. Because even as we sit here, I sat next to my brother there, and he had heard this call, not through his ears, but in his heart, that he must make haste to the Baytullah in order that he hearkens to the call to come. So that each one, when they respond to this call, they will be able one day to say, Labbaik Allahumma labbaik, labbaik la sharika la laka labbaik, inna alhamda wa ni'mata laka wal mulk, la sharika lak. I am present, O Allah, I am present. Inna alhamda, all the glory, all the praise and the thanks is to Allah. All the mulk belongs to Allah. And we make no partners with Allah, so that we cleanse ourselves of those things every day which compete for our attention and divert our attention away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so the call has been made. And the call is so overwhelming that the valleys of Mina, the valleys of Makkah, the plains of Muzdalifah, the Mount Rahma and the plain of Arafah can only hold so much within their borders, that not everyone who wants to come can come. And so they've imposed quotas on nations so that only some can come at a time. But no impediment is there for your niyyah to be able to be there, inshallah. That's not mine, eh? Okay. And so, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has predestined the site of this Hajj. When Allah says that we gave the site to Nabi Ibrahim for the sacred house to be established, a house whose foundations lay with Nabi Adam alayhi salatu wasalam, it has come and it has gone, but it has always been renewed, in order that no one may associate anything with Allah. And it is there for a purpose, that we may make the tawaf around the Kaaba, that we may stand in prayer, that we may make our ruku, and that we may make our sujood. Allah establishes the place and the purpose, and Allah establishes that the outcome must be that there must be no idols between Allah's slaves and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And while the idols of the time may have been statues and statuettes, the idols today are a lot more complex. It's the money we worship. It's the house we have so much pride in. It's the family we think is so perfect. It's the addictions we have to substances or other things. It's the aggressions we have within us that we can't control. The beating of our wives, the harshness with our children, the addictions of smoking or whatever the case may be. All of those things are the new idols of the new time. None of us stands in front of a statue to pray. But all of us have a little statue of addiction that is within us. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that we must purify the sight and we must purify our hearts, it is not that Allah fears the shirk that comes from a physical statue. It's that Allah fears the shirk that will come within us when we are overcome, that sometimes a rugby match on TV is more important than the adhan of Maghrib. Sometimes a movie time is so exact that it may distract. Sometimes our tempers are so strong that we can't control it even though we know we do wrong. Sometimes our tongues are so sharp that we can't control it even though we know it can hurt. And so each one of us is challenged, whether we are in Makkah or not, whether we are on Hajj or not. This is how we share in this beautiful rituals of cleansing ourselves and purifying our hearts of any form of shirk that may come our way. In the first ayah that I have recited, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala understands that there must be challenges. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala understands that there must be hardship. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala understands that there must be difficulty in doing the Hajj. Because Allah says, Allah makes provision for those who come on Hajj, on foot, or on animals, not on aeroplanes and on ships, and on trains nowadays. And Allah says that we will arrive, our animals will be lean, we who have walked will be lean, we will be exhausted from going over hills and long distances through valleys. There must be some hardship, because the nature of ibadah in Islam is that it must free up the soul to reach Allah and to communicate with Allah. And sometimes our bodies get in the way. Sometimes our stomachs are hungry. And sometimes our lusts are overwhelming. And sometimes our tiredness is so much that we sleep through the waqts. That Allah knows that the bodies must be disrupted if the soul is to emerge. That is why Fajr is not at the time that we can control. It is sometimes at the beginning part of the night, sometimes in the middle part of the night, and sometimes in the later part of the night. But it must disrupt our sleep so that our soul can stand in front of Allah and our bodies be subjected to the discipline that comes with Salah. Sometimes people ask us, how can you fast without water? Not even water. Because sometimes we are so busy satisfying our bodies that our souls go into comfort and go into recession. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala must have the pangs of hunger and thirst with us so that our souls can emerge and show its power and dominance over our bodies. The Hajj on one day alone, from Mina to Arafah, Arafah to Muzdalifah, Muzdalifah to the Jamarat al-Aqaba. On our pedometers, it counted 30 kilometers in 50 degrees heat. Our bodies were browbeaten, but wallahi, our souls were elated, because for the first time that connection with Allah was not mediated through the comfort of our bodies. We don't know how we put one step in front of another, but our bodies were dominated because our souls could then emerge. Alhamdulillah. That is the nature of ibadah. It's for your soul to emerge, not for your bodies to be in comfort. But that is what Allah expects from a slave of Allah, from Ibadur Rahman, the slave of the merciful, to show their soul, to replenish their soul. But there's a very intriguing verse. I've recited to you in English, verse 26 of Surah Hajj. I've recited to you in Arabic, verse 27 of Surah Al-Hajj. But there is a verse just before that, verse 25 of Surah Al-Hajj, in which Allah wants natural attrition of the body. Allah wants the natural hardship of the body that will make the soul emerge. But in verse 25, ayah 25, Allah speaks about the Quraysh, the Kuffar, who prevented people from the Masjid al-Haram. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in that ayah, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ قَفَرُوا وَيَسُدُّونَ عَنْ سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. As to those who rejected Allah and who keep back the Muslims from the way of Allah, well, Masjid al-Haram, and from the sacred mosque. Then Allah says very clearly, the sacred mosque which Allah has made open to all people, equal is the inhabitant of the people of the sacred mosque and the visitor. On the days of Hajj, the Meccans have no more equal right to the Haram and to the precincts of Hajj than the visitors. We have equal access. And then Allah gives a warning not only to the kuffar of the time, but it's a lesson we must understand for all times. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and any whose purpose, whose intention is to deviate from the right path, from the path of justice, in doing justice to the Hujjaj, whether a profanity or whether an act of wrongdoing, we will cause them to taste a most grievous penalty. Unfortunately, there are those who have fallen into the habits of the Quraysh and the Kuffar of the time. And our Hujjaj are so purified and so renewed that they fear even the mention of a problem. They fear even the glimpse of a complaint. They fear anything that may imperil or endanger their Hajj. They will not think, say, or do anything that could for a moment remove the maqbool and the mabrur from their Hajj. And who can blame them? They don't know whether they will be there again to seek forgiveness and to renew the maqbool and to renew the mabrur. And so they suffer in silence. They come back bankrupted because while they were there, they had to send for more money. They come there ill because while they were there, they suffered indignities that they may not otherwise have needed to suffer. And while they were there, they bottled up angers and resentments that they may not otherwise have felt the need to do it because they fear that they endanger their Hajj. It is for that reason that when President Ramaphosa met with His Highness King Salman and they discussed the issue of the quota, the king said, "We will increase the quota for South Africans, but get your house in order." When the president came back and the minister, Naledi Pandor, came back from that visit, they established this ministerial committee for the efficient management of the Hajj so that, inshallah, we could do our side of the bargain, get our house in order, and they could then prepare for an increase in Hujjaj. As a deposit on the promise, we suddenly had an increase from 2,500 to 3,500 Hujjaj. It came suddenly, not everyone was ready for it. But that was almost a deposit on the promise, and that put so much pressure on the South Africans and this ministerial committee that I'm chairperson of, so much pressure to start getting our house in order, that it was felt that the Muslim members of the committee must experience what the Hujjaj are experiencing. We were offered by the Saudis the VIP treatment. We were offered by others the Camp A treatment. But we said, put us where the 3,400 Hujjaj will be in Camp D, Camp 31, from Mina to Arafah to Muzdalifah back to Mina. Let us experience it. Don't give us buses and convoys. Let us walk as they walk. Let us eat what they eat. Let us sleep on what they sleep on. And alhamdulillah, and let us use, most importantly, the toilets and the washrooms that they use. My dear brothers and sisters, some of those indignities are not what is meant by Allah. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, subject your body so that your soul may emerge. And therefore, we have been so burdened by what we have experienced and what we have heard from the Hujjaj and what we had seen for ourselves, that it is one of the most onerous things to come from Hajj as a Haji. And then to sit with this pressure of expectation that inshallah we should for 2024 see an improvement. I want to say that it is not one that only South Africans face. I've met with the Minister of Hajj. I've met with the Deputy Minister of Hajj, the Director General of Hajj, the head of the Mutawif company that deals with non-Arab African pilgrims. And we have met with all and the Alawi family who are the traditional host for almost the last century of the South African Hujjaj. We have been able to explain to them what our case is. In some cases, they admit that there is an infrastructural problem. Camp A, for example, is next to the Jamarat. Camp 31, where we were, are on the farthest end from the Jamarat. We have to walk the furthest. We have to plan the best. And we do so under great difficulty. But it also appears, my dear brothers and sisters, that, for example, the water pressure is higher at Camp A. And when the water pressure comes to Camp 31, Camp D, where the non-Arab African Hujjaj are, the water pressure is so non-existent that it can't flush the toilets. That is not what Allah meant for the hardships that's natural to Hajj. Because Tahara is the key to Salah, and Salah the key to Jannah. I am not speaking about what I have heard. I am speaking about what we have experienced. And so we can go on to say that these are the challenges that we face as a ministerial committee. And fortunately, after one day in Mina, when the minister of Hajj sent his convoy to fetch us for a meeting that we did not expect will happen, the last thing that I did was to take wudu in those conditions. And we could explain to him that this is not what we expect. And we hope that it is not one that only your non-Arab Africans are exposed to. Because then there is an additional problem. Because so much of the Hajj is based on a ritual from a non-Arab African woman who was enslaved and exiled, Sayyidatina Hajar. May Allah be pleased with her. The whole sa'i, the whole running between Safa and Marwa is based on the ritual of an African woman. And if 2.4 million Hujjaj come to do what she has done, then the descendants of Sayyidina Hajar must not be subjected to this kind of treatment. And so, inshallah, we have invited people, especially the Hujjaj, to tell us what their reflections are, so that before 2024, we can go back. And in fact, the Minister of Hajj, we have extended an invitation for him to hold a Hajj symposium, not in Makkatul Mukarrama, not in Madinatul Munawwara, but in a place like Johannesburg, where we invite the southern African states to all come together and we speak to him as non-Arab Africans about what are the minimum expectations of the Hujjaj of South Africa and the region, so that inshallah we may be ready for 2024. I am of the opinion that if we take a doubling, as the king has promised, a doubling of the quota from 2,500 to 5,000 Hujjaj for South Africa, and the Saudis are not ready with toilets, with water infrastructure, with sleeping space, and with shelter, then it may be an exercise in dashed expectations, that we may be more hated by our people if we cram 5,000 people into a space that can't even hold 3,000 people. So that is the hard negotiations that we would have to be making, inshallah. But my respected brothers and sisters, whatever difficulties we have faced, it does not detract from a Hajj that was essentially good. Because added to all the maghfirah, the forgiveness, to all the tawbah, the repentance, was the virtue of patience, biting our tongues when in Cape Town we would have sworn at someone, holding our fists when in Cape Town we could have beaten someone. That is the testament of the caliber of Hujjaj that you have here. Up till today, I've not heard a single Haji tell me about the toilets. I'm saying it because if I ignore it, then there's something wrong. I need you to know that I know, and that will be reflected in how we deal with these things, inshallah. I must say that I've seen South African volunteers do yeoman work. There was a day on Arafah, almost 50 degrees. South Africans were in a tent mixing tang, buying ice, throwing it in barrels, mixing tang, and all the African Hujjaj lining up for kilometers outside our tent on that day, getting refreshments so that they could go on with their call for maghfirah. That is how we are seen in that part of the world. And if we complain, my dear brothers and sisters, please remember, right outside Camp 31, on the streets of Mina, sleeping on cardboard, were Hujaj from Senegal, from Mali, from Ghana, from Nigeria. We are complaining, as we should, but there are others who have had it infinitely worse. But not one of them, not once have you seen someone lose their iman because of the conditions. So maybe Allah has given us greater faith as a result of the tests that we have gone through. Maybe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has tested us more and we have passed the test, inshallah. And so we hope, inshallah, that having shared some of this with you and giving you a sense that we will in September, inshallah, give a report to the minister and the president, and that after that we will be having the minister of Hajj over for the symposium on Hajj, because he has accepted our invitation to come with the Alawi family, to come with the Mutawif company, and to engage us on our conditions, that inshallah we are hopeful that not only will the quotas improve, but the conditions will improve. The minister of Hajj said, no, there'll be more space for the South African Hujaj, because now American Muslims have come down from 30,000 to 4,000 Hujaj. They are now being treated like us. The British Muslims have come down from 20,000 to 3,000 Hujaj. There's more space. And I joked with them and said, but minister, will you send their toilets to us? Because it's one thing making space that side, but it's another thing not bringing the amenities to us. And so, my respected brothers and sisters, let us not forget that the purpose of Hajj has been achieved, alhamdulillah. Because Allah promises us in Surah Zumar, and as we saw the Hujaj sit on Arafah, pleading forgiveness, getting to know themselves, understanding their character faults, understanding their behavioral faults, understanding the faults that they have in their relationships, and then gathering their 49 to 70 stones on Muzdalifah, each stone representing their fault, each stone being used for the Jamarat to throw, not at the Jamarat, because that's just a stone wall. It is the act of that stone by saying, I am an arrogant person. Let me throw my arrogance away. And then, Bismillahi Allahu Akbar. I am a person who is violent and has a temper. Let me throw my temper away. Bismillahi Allahu Akbar. And so we go. I am not a loving husband. I am a harsh father. Let me throw that away. Bismillahi Allahu Akbar. That is the forgiveness that the Hujaj have earned. It is not an exclusive one. We may not all have the pleasure of and the honor of being invited and having the means to come to Makkah for our Hajj. But we all have the opportunity every day to call for maghfirah, to engage in tawbah, in seeking forgiveness from those around us, so that inshallah the promise of Allah is always true when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Kul ya ibadiya alladhina asrafu ala anfusihim. Say, O my servants who have transgressed against their own souls. Remember, whenever we sin, we don't sin against Allah, because Allah is free of anything that we may want or need. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O my servants who have transgressed against their own souls, la taqnatu min rahmatillah. Never ever despair of the mercy of Allah. Never ever despair of the mercy of Allah. La taqnatu min rahmatillah. Never ever despair of the mercy of Allah. Nothing that you have done is greater than what Allah can forgive. Nothing that you are is worse than what Allah can forgive. Nothing that what you do is worse than what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can accept as a return. لا تقنطوا من رحمة الله. Allah forgives all sins. That is the belief that we must carry around with us. We don't have to wait for Arafah, for the day of atonement, for the day of repentance, and for the day of forgiveness. Make it now. You won't know whether the quota will allow you, your health will allow you, your money will allow you to be on Arafah, to have that forgiveness in the best place for forgiveness. But you can get it right where you are sitting. Every day in your homes, you can renew yourselves and be like a mini Haji every day of your life. وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين.
تكبير الله أكبر ولله الحمد. جزاك الله خير شكرا and paya terima kasih to our ambassador Al-Hajj Brother Ibrahim Rasul for a very soul-stirring nasiha coming straight from a very pure and cleansed heart. May Almighty Allah accept, may Allah grant us all the hidayah to understand and to implement this beautiful message, inshallah, and may this message go throughout that people can understand and benefit from this beautiful nasiha. Haji Ibrahim, like many other hujjaj who came back, are not in the best of health, but alhamdulillah, he still came and delivered his message. And likewise, his wife, Aunty Rashida, is in bed at the moment with the flu. We ask that Allah grant the shifa. And for all our people in home and at home and in hospital, Allah grant them shifa and kamila. Just allow me to mention to you that alhamdulillah, our ambassador, Al-Hajj Brother Ibrahim Rasul, is the chairperson of the Ministerial Committee for the Efficient Management and Running of the Hajj and Umrah. This is a government-instituted body, and alhamdulillah, I feel confident that Ambassador Ibrahim Rasul being at the helm of the affairs, we see light for the future, for our hujjaj and our mu'tamirin, because there's many issues that we need to look at. There's the great issue of affordability of the Hajj. It's a major obstacle, affordability. Prices are sky high, but amazingly, Allah has taken our hujjaj. Allah's hand is on the hujjaj. There we've heard how the temperature reached nearly 50 degrees and more, but Allah's hand of rahmah is on his honorable guests. Alhamdulillah. May Almighty Allah grant success and grant your brother Ibrahim Rasul that you will be that efficient leader that is needed here in South Africa, especially for the Hajj, that Hajj can be made more smooth and easy for all those who make the niyyah and want to go, inshallah. We wish you all the success. Amen. And then, of course, I just have a few announcements. We have been asked to make dua, shifa. We've been requested by Yasin Mauser to make dua for Ridwan Mauser, who is in Vincent Pallotti Hospital, in the best of health. Also, Shifa dua requested by Fozia Virasami to make dua for her sister Khawa Kanemeyer, who is also not in the best of health. And we make dua for Abdurrahman Parker, the brother-in-law of Hanif Parker of the Taj Radio and Taj Radio Shop. He passed away in the week. May Allah grant him and all our deceased Jannatul Firdaus. Amin. And also we had in the week the janaza of the toddler, two-year-old Hassan, who is the son of Hussein Khatib, 2 years old, who passed away in the week. May Allah grant all our deceased the highest of Jannatul Firdaus. Amin, Ya Rabbal Alameen. And then, of course, not this coming Tuesday, the following Tuesday, on the 18th of July, we will be celebrating the International Mandela Volunteer Day. And alhamdulillah, Brother Majid Mauser has organized a group of doctors who have volunteered free of charge to be here, not this Tuesday, next Tuesday, on the 18th of July, at my Tuesday morning housewife forum class on the Tuesday, and it's open for all ladies, where this group of doctors will free of charge do blood sugar and blood pressure and all other related ailments. They will do it free of charge only for that day. So all the ladies, you are most welcome to attend our weekly Tuesday morning housewife forum program here at Masjid Al-Quds. We on a weekly basis, on a Tuesday, we have up to 500-600 ladies attending our Tuesday morning housewife forum class. Alhamdulillah. So in conclusion, once again, Hajj Maqbool to all our Hujjaj. Our Salah, inshallah, will be led by Hafiz Muhammad Yasin Mansur Royke. And afterwards, after the Salah, we will ask Hafiz Muhammad Tayyib, who has also returned from Hajj, he will make the dua, because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made a special dua, and the Prophet made the dua by saying, Allahumma ghfir lil Hajj wa liman istaghfara lahul Hajj. Oh Allah, forgive each and every Hajji, and forgive all those people whom the Hujjaj are making istighfar and dua for. So we must ask the Hujjaj, Ambassador Ibrahim, Hafiz Tayyib, Brother Naseem, who is back, and all the Hujjaj, please we ask you, Dr. Salim Parker, you make dua for us. Your dua is accepted. And as we traditionally believe that the duas of the Hujjaj are accepted for the next 40 days, may it be 40 years, amen. 40 days since your coming back, the day of your coming back, your dua. So go to the Hujjaj, meet them, greet them, because the angels, what we're going to read in our Arabic khutbah, the dua, the hadith where the Prophet say, go and meet the Hujjaj, greet them, because as they came back, the angels, the farishtas of Allah, the angels, the malaika, they rush towards the Hujjaj. They embrace them, they hug them, they kiss them, and they are still making dua for the Hujjaj. So they are special people. They are still the ambassadors, our ambassadors, and they are the honored guests of Allah who must now make dua for us. Ameen. Once again, it's not the last time. I hope soon in the near future, Ambassador Ibrahim, that we'll have you back here at this podium to inspire us with your dynamic nasiha. Ameen ya Rabbil Alameen. Walhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Can I ask everyone to kindly come forward? If you can just do me a favor, please, Kanala, to kindly stand up, Kanala, and just move forward. Wherever you see a space in front of you, that space is rightfully yours. Shukran, bye, terima kasih.
Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله. أشهد أن محمد رسول الله. أشهد أن محمد رسول الله. حي على الصلاة. حي على الصلاة. حي على الفلاح. حي على الفلاح. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. لا
إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين وأذل الشرك والمشركين، رب اختم لنا بالخير برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين، والحمد لله رب العالمين.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته.
الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر، أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، أشهد أن محمد رسول الله، أشهد أن محمد رسول الله. حي على الصلاة، حي على الصلاة، حي على الفلاح، حي على الفلاح. الله أكبر الله أكبر، لا إله إلا الله.
الحمد لله، الحمد لله الذي اصطفى لحجه عبادا، واجتبى لهم بقربه مواسم وأعيادا، ووطأ لهم على فراش كرامته مهادا، وسقى قلوبهم من سحائب رحمته ودادا. أحمده حمدا طيبا مقبولا مجابا، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له شهادة من شهدها فقد أذن له الرحمن وقال صوابا، وأشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا محمدًا عبده ورسوله سيد الخلق شيوخا وكهولا والشبابا. اللهم فصل وسلم وبارك على هذا النبي الكريم والرسول السيد السند العظيم سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه صلاة وسلاما دائمين متلازمين يمحن الله بهما أجرا جزيلا جزاء من ربك عطاء حسابا، وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا. فيا أمة التوحيد، إن الحجاج قد رجعوا عليكم وكانوا ضيوف الرحمن، جاءوا ببركة تلك الأماكن الشريفة إليكم، قد تملوا بطوافهم بالبيت الحرام واستلامهم الحجر الأسود وصلاتهم خلف مقام إبراهيم، وشربوا من ماء زمزم، وسعوا بين الصفا والمروة، وظفروا بسعد كامل الصفا لما محيت أوزارهم يوم الوقوف بعرفة. وها هم قد وصلوا إلى أوطانهم، فتلقوهم أحسن اللقاء حيهم أحسن التحية، واسألوهم الاستغفار لكم الحديث. قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم: اللهم اغفر للحاج ولمن استغفر له الحاج. فيا أيها الحاج، أوصيكم كل الوصية ألا تدنس حجك بمعصية رب البرية، بل دم على طهار توبتك والزم سبيلها، فمتى يا مسكين تنال حجا مثلها؟ وقد قيل: معصية بعد توبة أقبح من 70 ذنبا قبلها. وقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم: إن الملائكة يتلقون الحاج فيسلمون على أصحاب الجمال، ويصافحون أصحاب البغال والحمير، ويعانقون الرجال. أو كما قال: صدقت يا سيدي يا حبيبي يا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. قال الله تعالى في القرآن المجيد بعد: أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، قل لعبادي الذين أسرفوا على أنفسهم لا تقنطوا من رحمة الله،
إنه إن الله يغفر الذنوب جميعا إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. صدق الله مولانا العظيم. بارك الله لنا ولكم بالقرآن العظيم ونفعنا وإياكم بالآيات والذكر الحكيم. أقول قولي هذا أستغفر الله أستغفر الله أستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم ولوالدي ولوالديكم ولسائر المسلمين والمسلمات والمؤمنين والمؤمنات. فتوبوا إلى الله إنه كان غفارا.
اللهم صل وسلم وزد وتوانم وتفضل وبارك جلالك وكمالك على زين عبادك واشرف عبادك سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى ال سيدنا محمد وصحبه وسلم سلم ورضي الله تبارك وتعالى عن كل صحابه اجمعين.
الحمد لله الحمد لله حمدا كثيرا كما امر، والصلاه والسلام على سيد البشر. اشهد ان لا اله الا الله وحده لا شريك له، واشهد ان سيدنا ومولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله. قال الله تعالى في القران المجيد بعد اعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم: وما أرسلناك إلا رحمة للعالمين. وقال تعالى: إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد كما صليت على سيدنا إبراهيم وعلى آل سيدنا إبراهيم، وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد كما باركت على سيدنا إبراهيم وعلى آل سيدنا إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. وارض اللهم عن خلفاء الراشدين أمير المؤمنين سيدنا أبي بكر الصديق وأمير المؤمنين سيدنا عمر بن الخطاب وأمير المؤمنين سيدنا عثمان بن عفان وأمير المؤمنين سيدنا علي بن أبي طالب رضي الله تعالى عنهم وعن بقية الصحابة والقرابة والتابعين وتابع التابعين وتابعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين. اللهم اجعل هذا البلد آمنا مطمئنا وسائر بلاد المسلمين أجمعين. فاغفر لنا وارحمنا وعافنا واعف عنا واحفظنا يا الله يا الله من كل بلاء الدنيا وعذاب الآخرة. اللهم اجعل حج حجنا مبرورا وسعينا سعيا مشكورا وذنوبنا ذنوبا مغفورا وعملنا عملا صالحا مقبولا وتجارة لن تبور. يا نور النور يا عالم ما في الصدور أخرجنا يا الله يا الله من الظلمات إلى النور. ربنا تقبل كل واحد منا عمرة وحج بيتك الحرام. اللهم ارزقنا صلاة في المسجد الأقصى وهو حر عزيز. اللهم أعد المسجد الأقصى إلى رحاب المسلمين إلى أخويه المسجد الحرام ومسجد النبوي المدني الشريف. آمين يا رب العالمين. عباد الله رحمكم الله، إن الله يأمركم بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر، ولذكر الله تعالى أعلى وأولى وأعز وأجل وأتم وأهم وأعظم وأكبر. والله يعلم ما تصنعون. وأقم الصلاة. Kindly fill up all the staffs, heels on the line, shoulder to shoulder please.
الله أكبر الله أكبر. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله. خير الصلاة خير الفلاح قد قامت الصلاة قد قامت الصلاة. الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله.
الله أكبر. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين، اهدنا الصراط المستقيم، صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. آمين. الله نور السماوات والأرض، مثل نوره كمشكاة فيها مصباح، المصباح في زجاجة، الزجاجة كأنها كوكب دري يوقد من شجرة مباركة مباركة زيتونة لا شرقية ولا غربية ولا غربية يكاد زيتها يضيء ولو لم تمسسه نار، نور على نور، يهدي الله لنوره من يشاء ويضرب الله الأمثال للناس، والله بكل شيء عليم. الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين، اهدنا الصراط المستقيم، صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. آمين. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ألم نشرح لك صدرك ووضعنا عنك وزرك الذي أنقض ظهرك ورفعنا لك ذكرك، فإن مع العسر يسرا، إن مع العسر يسرا، فإذا فرغت فانصب وإلى ربك فارغب. الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. استغفر الله استغفر الله استغفر الله العظيم التواب الرحيم الذي لا إله إلا هو الحي القيوم وأتوب إليه ونسألك توبة ومغفرة إنه هو التواب الرحيم.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. اللهم أنت السلام ومنك السلام تباركت ربنا وتعاليت يا ذا الجلال والإكرام. سمعنا وأطعنا غفرانك ربنا وإليك المصير. اللهم ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. ربنا ظلمنا أنفسنا وإن لم تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكونن من الخاسرين. ربنا اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وإسرافنا في أمرنا وثبت أقدامنا وانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب. اللهم أجرنا من النار اللهم أجرنا من النار اللهم أجرنا من النار وأدخلنا الجنة مع الأبرار يا عزيز يا غفار يا رب العالمين. اللهم حجهم حجا مبرورا وسعيهم سعيا مشكورا وذنوبهم ذنوبا مغفورا وعملهم عملا صالحا مقبولا وتجارتهم تجارة لن تبور. يا نور النور يا عالم ما في الصدور أخرجنا يا الله أخرجنا يا الله أخرجنا يا الله وإياهم من الظلمات إلى النور. اللهم اغفر لهم وارحمهم وسكنهم في الجنة اللهم اغفر لهم وارحمهم وسكنهم في الجنة اللهم اغفر لهم وارحمهم وسكنهم في الجنة وتجاوز عن سيئاتهم واحشرهم مع النبيين والصديقين والشهداء والصالحين وحسن أولئك رفيقا ذلك الفضل من الله وكفى بالله عليما. اللهم اشف مرضانا اللهم اشف مرضانا اللهم اشف مرضانا وارحم موتانا برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد وأصحابه وبارك وسلم. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين. Thank you.